percentage of water and dried season is 8% of water. And regarding the dryness, it is a relative term, whereas the drying refers to the reducing the moisture content from an initial value to substantial acceptable final value. The finally, the solids, whichever the dried, it may be in a flakes form, granules form, crystals, powders, slabs, continuous sheets. So normally the moisture we are talking about here is frequently water, and how we are going to remove the water by applying a hot air gas. So final product coming from the dryer, it is taken for a final packaging unit. And if you take out the convective drying process, it is a convection. Whatever we talk about the drying is a mass transfer operation which comes under the convective process. There are two processes taking place. One is a transfer of energy from the local environment to the dryer. Another one is a transfer of moisture from within the solid. So if we talk about the mechanical methods like expression or centrifuging, it is not at all a drying. Only the convection mode of drying, we are going to talk it in our mass transfer biological systems unit. Examples for drying is in the case of sugar industry, the production of sugar crystals, and also in biological materials. For example, any food materials, if you want to preserve, the most probably the main method we need to follow is a drying method. In the case of food industry, the milk powder can be produced by drying process using a spray chamber. And normally, as you, the biotechnologist, you are well known, the microorganisms will cause food spoilage and decay and cannot grow and multiply. And in this case of enzymes also causes some chemical changes in food, and biological materials cannot function without water. And we need to reduce the water content of reduced 10% by 8%, then only the microbes will be inactive. So it is necessary to lower the moisture content below 5-8% to preserve the flavor and aroma. So normally what is the method to follow drying the biological materials, for example, like pharmaceuticals, is freeze drying or lyophilization. The lyophilization technique, as you all know, the lyophilization or freeze drying is nothing but the method used to dry the pharmaceutical as well as the biological materials. Freeze drying is nothing but you need to remove the water vapor by sublimation and then followed by a vacuum chamber. So finally, we'll get a freezed product. And the freezing process, the freeze drying, is one of the highest quality food product obtained compared to other drying methods. And regarding the theory of drying, you all know the drying happens, it's not at all a simple step. It has to undergo various steps. For example, there are three interrelated factors are there. One is the amount of water vapor present in the air, and the temperature of the air, and the amount of air that passes over the food. There are fundamental properties you're supposed to know understanding the drying process. These properties are psychrometric properties. The first property is the humidity. That is nothing but the amount of water vapor present in the air. So the humidity. The humidity can be defined as PW divided by P minus PW into mg minus mg. Similarly, the RH is to be relative humidity, PW divided by P0W into 100. So these two factors are very important in drying. Another one is the dry bed temperature. You all know the temperature of the air measured using exposed air, the dry environment. Whereas the wet bed temperature is measured by in a wet environment. These two definitions are very important. And this is a psychrometric chart which shows the various relationship between the air-water mixture, the WBT, TWBT, etc. And the next one is the two important properties for food product as well as the drying is, one is the moisture content. Okay, the moisture content is very important. The moisture content of a material can be expressed in two ways. One is in wet basis, another one is a dry basis. So wet basis is defined as the weight of water per unit weight of wet solid. For example, it is defined as XW is equal to X by X plus 1. Similarly, in the dry basis, X is equal to XW divided by 1 minus XW. So the two types of moisture content are there. One is a bound moisture, another one is a free moisture. Bound moisture is nothing but the amount of water tightly bound to the food matrix, mainly by physical absorption process. Whereas a free moisture is nothing but the moisture entrapped in void spaces of the system. And before knowing the drying process, there are some definitions. These definitions are understood. You need to understand the drying process. This is a graph showing the moisture content in different humidity conditions. So from this drying curve, we can understand what is the moisture content in wet basis. Small x, wet basis actually expressed in small x. It is defined as a weight of moisture per unit weight of wet substance. Similarly, dry basis, it is defined as a weight of moisture per unit weight of bone dry substance. And another definition is equilibrium moisture. The equilibrium moisture is very important in any drying material. So whenever we choose a drying process, the drying technicals will again think about the equilibrium moisture. The equilibrium moisture is nothing but the moisture content of a substance when it is at equilibrium with the given partial pressure of the vapor. It is actually equilibrium moisture. It is denoted by X star. Another one is a bound moisture. Already told that bound moisture is nothing but the moisture contained by a substance which exerts an equilibrium vapor pressure less than that of a pure liquid at the same temperature. And then unbound moisture is nothing but the moisture contained by a substance which exerts an equilibrium vapor pressure equal to that of a pure liquid. It should be unbound moisture, free mixed moisture, X minus X star. This is a moisture contained by a substance in excess of equilibrium moisture. In excess of equilibrium moisture, it is a free moisture. So from the graph, you can able to understand this, what are the types of moisture content. Another one is a critical moisture content. What is a critical moisture content is? The moisture content when the concentrate period going to be end. That is a critical moisture content. And then concentrate period, it is a rate period is nothing but the drying period in which the rate of water removed per unit area drying surface maintaining the constant. Similarly, falling rate period is once a concentrate period ends, it starts with the falling rate period. It shows a linear behavior. And similarly, another important 2 months question frequently asked is hysteresis in drying. We all know hysteresis is nothing but the phenomena in which if a material shows a two different behavior. For example, if you drying process, the two equilibrium moisture relationship exhibited by the drying process is adsorption and desorption. So adsorption and desorption are exhibited by the drying process. This is very important definition, hysteresis. And regarding the classification of drying operation, one is a batch drying. You all know batch process. Another semi-batch, which can be operated intermittently or cyclically under unsteady state operation. And another one is a continuous drying. So we first discussed about the batch drying. Before going for batch drying, we need to know what is a drying curve. So the two graphs are called as a drying curve. One is a typical red curve, another one is a drying test curve. And here we need to know what is the classification of drying. Already we told the classification batch, semi-batch and continuous drying. So before studying the batch drying, we need to know what is a drying test. Okay. So why we need to conduct a drying test? The drying test is conducted to find out the drying schedule and also to find out the size of the equipments. That is why we need to find out the drying test. How to carry out the drying test is, we need to take the sample and keep it in a drying chamber. It may be any tray chamber or maybe a spray dryer. So once you kept the sample, we need to take the weight of the material periodically and measure the weight. Then we need to plot the graph. That graph is supposed to be a drying curve. For example, here we plot a weight of the material in y-axis and x-axis at time. So you'll be getting a curve like this. It's supposed to be a drying curve. And based on the drying curve, we can find out the rate of the drying. Rate of the drying is nothing but the drying rate with respect to time. The rate of the drying n is given by minus ls by a into dx by dt, which is equal to minus 1 by a into dw by dt. So n is said to be a rate of a drying, and ls is the mass of a bone dry solid, and a is a drying surface. So if you consider the thorough circulation drying, for example, in industrial drying, so a is defined as a cross-sectional area of the bed perpendicular to the direction of the flow. So now we consider this graph. This graph is shown in the rate curve. You want to find out the rate of the reaction. So here we're taking the y-axis a drying rate n and x-axis moisture content. So here the various region, for example, you call it as a ED. ED is said to be the second falling rate period where the internal movement of moisture takes place. And then DC is said to be a first falling rate period where unsaturated surface drying is going to take place. And CB, which is nothing but the constant rate drying. And A dash B and AB are called as a unsteady state drying process. So in all the above process, we are going to remove the moisture content present in the sample. So what is it? We all know what is the mass transfer operation. The mass transfer operation is governed with the concentration gradient or any other gradient. Okay. So now we need to know what is the drying gradient. The drying, the mass transfer operation, the equation is given by Nc is equal to Ky into Ys minus Y. So Nc is nothing but the flux of mass transfer. Ky is a mass transfer coefficient. And Y dash S is a saturated humidity. And then Y is said to be a unsaturated air humidity. And now we need to find out that time of drying. So time of drying is calculated by the previous equation. N is equal to minus Ls by A into dx by dt. So now we need to find out the time. So rearrange the equation to find out the time. The time we have found out, time is equal to minus Ls by A integration of x1 to x2 dx by n. This is for time of drying. So now we need to consider the concentrate drying and falling rate period. So for the concentrate period, we need to take into account x1 and x2 are greater than Xe, that is nothing but the critical moisture content. So now n is equal to, when x1 and x2 are greater than Xe, the drying rate remains constant. That is said to be n is equal to Nc. So now we rearrange the equation and substituting the limits, we get time is equal to Ls into x1 minus x2 divided by Nc. This equation time t, which is for concentrate period. For example, falling rate period, you need to consider x1 x2 are less than Xe. That is nothing but critical period, less than the critical period. And finding out by deriving the equation, by taking the equation of a straight line, n is equal to ax plus b. So substituting the limits, we are finding out the time for constant falling rate period is equal to ls into x1 minus x2 divided by a into nm. So this falling rate and constant rate period derivation is very important in drying. Okay. So students, please make a note. This derivation is very important to find out the concentrate period and falling rate period. And another special case is that for if you consider the drying taking place from critical moisture content to the equilibrium moisture content. So the special derivation one in special case is that it is nothing but time is equal to Ls into Xc minus equilibrium moisture content divided by A into Nc into ln of X1 minus X star divided by X2 minus X star. So these two important derivation in a drying unit. And regarding the drying equipment, so we have various types of drying equipments based on the phenomena. If it is a direct contact, the dryers have direct contact with the hot gas, example a rotary dryer, spray dryer, etc. If it is an indirect contact, there is no direct contact between the gas and the drying will be taking place, example drum dryer, mechanically agitated dryer, etc. And another operation based on the type of operation, you all know the another batch dryer. So tray dryers, freeze dryers operate in batch operation. Continuous dryers, example rotary dryer, mechanically agitated dryer, tunnel dryers. Based on the nature of the substance to be dried, we can classify. If the material in the form of sheets or masses, we can give an example batch dryers, atmospheric tray and vacuum tray, continuous dryers, tunnel dryers. If the material is in the form of a granular or loose, we can use a rotary dryers, turbo dryers, conveyors, filters. If the materials what is going to obtain is continuous sheets, we can use a cylinder dryer or pistol dryers. If it is in the form of a pastes or sludges, we can use atmospheric agitated dryers and vacuum dryers. If it is a materials in the form of solution, we use a drum dryers and spray dryers. Special dryers command as freeze dryers, infrared dryers, and dielectric dryers. And this is the drying equipments: tray dryers, tunnel dryers, roller dryers, fluidized bed dryers, spray dryers, pneumatic dryers, rotary dryers, etc. And this is another important 16 marks question. So drying equipment you're supposed to study. So here, if you choose, this is a diagram of various equipments: tray dryer, roller dryer, fluidized bed dryer, pneumatic dryer, rotary dryer, and then a freeze dryer and a spray dryers. And the types of dryer I'm going to talk about, one is a vacuum shelf, another one is a rotary vacuum dryer, freeze dryer, and spray dryers. So if you take a hot air dryers, it is one of major category. So what is the phenomena here is we need to pass the hot air. This hot air is going to contact with the product. And heat is supplied by convection. Okay. So these dryers, we can give example clean dryers, cabinet dryers, tray or compartment dryers, tunnel dryers, conveyor dryers, bin dryers, fluidized bed dryers, etc. And also spray dryers also come under the hot air dryers. So another one is a vacuum shelf dryers. A good example is a tray dryer. So this is a diagram of a tray dryers where the material is placed inside. The material is placed inside and we have a trays, various number of trays are there. The material is placed and it is heated. And here what happened here is, the material gets heated one by the application of hot air. But another one is a direct contact drying. Here the material is direct contact with the heater surface. The heat is going to be conducted by conduction. Examples are drum dryers, roller dryers, and vacuum pan dryers. This is a very good example. Another one is a rotary vacuum dryers is nothing but it operated under vacuum. So by condensing the vapors, it is going to be happen. What are the special features of rotary vacuum dryer is granular pasty wet materials can be handled, low temperature operation, it can be solvent recovery purpose, it can be used as a batch wise, high energy efficient, mode of heating is indirect, and conduction drying. Another one is a closed operation. The application of rotary vacuum dryers, whereas various fields, pharmaceuticals, organic chemicals, pasty materials, insecticides, dye stuffs, dye intermediates, pesticides, and solvent recovery. And freeze dryers, we talk about, it is a specimen, you have to keep it in a frozen state. And I already told that the sublimation followed by vacuum operation, we get a frozen material. The freeze dryers otherwise from the lyophilization process. Only the heat liable materials, including proteins, antibiotics, vitamins, blood plasma, hormones, and tissue, microorganisms can be used for drying the freeze dryers. And the final one is spray dryer. The spray dryer is only used for thermal sensitive materials such as foods and pharmaceuticals. Normally the milk powder we use to manufacture by using the spray dryers. Nitrogen is used for oxygen sensitive or flammable solvent such as ethanol. Application in food industries, it can be used for milk powder, coffee making, tea, eggs, cereals, spices and flourings. Pharmaceutical antibiotics, medical ingredients, additives. Industries like paint, pigments, ceramic materials, catalysts and supports. And this is a schematic diagram of a spray dryer. So if you see the spray dryer, the slurry feed is the feed whatever we're going to apply on the top layer. And we have to pass the hot air by a nozzle. So once the hot air contacts with the slurry feed, what happens? There is a convection going to take place and the moisture content gets removed and cold moisture is getting down and we'll be getting a solid product which is a form of granules. And regarding another topic we need to discuss is convective mass transfer. It's come under the unit 2. It is very important topic, this convective mass transfer. So what do you mean by a convective mass transfer? First of all, we know what is a convection. The convection is nothing but the transport of material from a boundary surface and a moving fluid. There are two types of convection. One is a forced convection, another one is a natural convection. So what is the first conversion is, if you use any external agency, for example, pumps or any compressors, the product, the process that we are forced one. Natural conversion is nothing but naturally. For example, density differences, concentration differences, temperature differences come under the natural conversion. And regarding the rate equation for convective mass transfer, we can give Na is equal to Kc into delta into Ca. So Na is said to be the molar flux, and Kc is the convective mass transfer coefficient. And delta Ca is said to be a concentration difference between the boundary surface concentration and the average concentration. So this is very important rate equation for convective mass transfer. And what do you mean by mass transfer coefficient? So first you have to know mass transfer coefficient, Kc. So from the general rate equation, we can found Na is equal to Kc into delta into Ca. The mass transfer coefficient is the rate of mass transfer per unit area per unit driving force. So it gives how much amount of convection going to take place. It is very important that that they will be asking 2 marks. What is the mass transfer coefficient? The mass transfer coefficient gives the how fast the convection going to happen. Okay. Then what are the factors which governs Kc? That is the mass transfer coefficient. One is the properties of the fluid. Another one is the dynamic characteristics of the flowing fluid. And another one is geometry of the physical system. And then when we talk about the molecular transport equation, for example, the transport rate transport equation is nothing but driving force divided by resistance. Okay. So there are three modes. There are, for example, the we have a momentum transfer, we have a heat transfer, we have a mass transfer. Okay. So these are said to be a three types of mode transfer. And the first one is momentum transfer. The equation is called a Newton's law. Tau is equal to V into d rho by dV. And the heat transfer is called as a Fourier's law of convection. And mass transfer is called as a Fick's law of convection. Okay. So there is a molecular diffusivity. We need to know what is a convective mass transfer. The significant parameter is a diffusivity. So this diffusivity, before knowing the diffusivity, we have to know what is a dimensionless parameters. You know what is the dimensionless parameters. Example is a Reynolds number, Prandtl number, Schmidt number. All doesn't have any unit, that is a dimensionless number. So we need to know what is the three transfer process. One is a momentum, heat, another one is a mass. So all the three transfer process, we have a diffusivities. So in the case of momentum, it is called as a momentum diffusivity. In heat transfer, it is called as a thermal diffusivity. And mass transfer, it is called as a mass diffusivity. So the three diffusivities, we called as a momentum diffusivity, thermal diffusivity, and mass diffusivity. So momentum diffusivity denoted by mu and thermal diffusivity denoted by alpha, and mass diffusivity is Bab. So in all the, if you see this, all the diffusivities, the dimensions, if you take L square by T, it will be, there is no unit. Okay, that if you cancel out, and we'll be having a dimensionless numbers. Okay, another important definition on a dimensionless numbers, suppose more Prandtl number. What do you mean by a Prandtl number in the case of a heat transfer? Is Prandtl number is nothing but the ratio of momentum diffusivity to the thermal diffusivity, that is nothing but V by alpha, which is mu Cp by K. It is also very important 2 marks question. And another one is a Schmidt number, the analogous number called dimensionless Schmidt number. The Schmidt number is defined as the momentum diffusivity divided by mass diffusivity, that is mu by rho into dAb. And another one is a Lewis number, thermal diffusivity divided by mass diffusivity, which is nothing but alpha by dAb, which is nothing but K rho C by dAb. And Sherwood number, it is also an important dimensionless number, Sherwood number, which is nothing but molecular mass transport resistance divided by convective mass transport resistance, KCL by dA. So these dimensionless numbers are always important. They will be asking in 2 marks. So these are all the dimensionless numbers used in correlating the mass transfer data. One is a Reynolds number. You all know Reynolds number, RE, Sherwood number, SH, Schmidt number, SC, Lewis number, LE, Prandtl number, PR, Eklek number, Stanton number, Grassof number. And another important mass transfer number is J factor. That is nothing but JD. JD factor, you will call it as a JD factor in mass transfer. And the heat transfer is called as a JH factor. So JD is given by Kc by V infinity, Fick number to the power of 2 by 3. In the case of a heat transfer, J factor, JH is equal to H by rho Cp V infinity, the Prandtl to the number of 2 by 3. So these dimensionless numbers are very important. And convective mass transfer correlations is also very important in the case of a convective mass transfer topic. One is a mass transfer correlation for flat plate. So it is a correlation, you're supposed to know, that is Sherwood number for the length of the plate, flat plate is given by 0.664 into Reynolds number to the power of 0.5 into Schmidt number to the power of 0.33. That is a laminar. If the Reynolds number is less than 2, it can go ahead. But in the case of a turbulent, 0.0365 into Reynolds number to the power of 0.8 into Schmidt number to the power of 0.33. Turbulent region, which is greater than 2, it can go ahead. This is very equation for flat plate. Similarly, we have a mass transfer equation for correlations for single spheres. So this could be asking in 2 marks, Sherwood number is equal to 2 plus 3 into Reynolds number to the power of m and Schmidt number to the power of 0.33. Similarly, for single sphere, you are given the equation. Similarly, we have a mass tensor correlations for single cylinders. The single cylinders come under mass tensor equation. We have a Kc, Smith number to the power of 0.56, here at the V infinity, which is equal to 0.281. Reynolds number to the B to the power of minus 0.4. But similarly, for flow through pipes, we have a correlation. Sherwood number is equal to 0.032, Reynolds number to the power of 0.8, and the Smith number to the power of 0.33. And this, for this equation is valid for the condition Reynolds number is less than of 2000 to 35,000, and the Smith number is 1000 to 2260. And we all talk about analogy. Another important question in the convective mass transfer is analogy of mass, heat, and momentum transfer. So this is very important topic. It's frequently asked in 16 marks question, analogy of mass, heat, and momentum transfer. So I already told that we have the basic equations for mass, heat, and momentum transfer. For the mass, it's come from a Fick's law of diffusion, and the heat, it comes from Fourier's law of conduction, and momentum, it's come from Newton's law. So to find out these, first we consider the mass transfer. We all know well-known equation Fick's law, JA is equal to minus DAB into DCA by DZ. JA is a flux and DAB is a diffusivity coefficient. DCA by DZ is said to be a concentration gradient. Similarly, in heat transfer, we can give Fourier's law. Q is equal to minus K dT by dx. Q is a rate of heat transfer area. K is a heat transfer coefficient. dT by dz is temperature gradient. K is a thermal conductivity. Similarly, in the case of momentum transfer, we use a Newton's law. Tau is equal to mu into dU by dz. But tau is equal to shear stress, and mu is called as a viscosity of the fluid. Based combining these three, momentum, heat, and mass transfer, we can find out the analogy of mass transfer. So the basic assumptions made in all these analogies is, one is the properties, physical properties, which are constant, and there is no mass and energy produced in the system, and there is no chemical reaction taking place, and there is no emission and absorption of energy, there is no dissipation of heat, and there is the velocity profile is not affected with mass transfer. And these five assumptions are made in all the analogy. For example, Reynolds analogy, Crichton-Corbin analogy, Prandtl analogy, etc. First, we will see the Reynolds analogy. One of the important analogy is called Reynolds analogy. In Reynolds analogy, the main, what the postulation of Reynolds is, the transfer of momentum, energy, and mass is said to be identical. So according to the Reynolds analogy, Kc by V infinity is equal to H by rho V infinity Cp, which is equal to F by 2. Here, F is called as a friction factor, and H is said to be heat transfer coefficient, rho is the density, and V infinity is the velocity, and Kc is said to be a mass transfer coefficient. So Reynolds have given an analogy based on this momentum, energy, and mass. It should be identical one, and this is well-known analogy. It is used in convection mass transfer. And similarly, we have another type of analogy like Prandtl analogy, Crichton-Corbin analogy. The Crichton-Corbin analogy is analogy come under the come after the Reynolds analogy. So according to the Crichton-Corbin analogy, they have defined one mass transfer factor called J factor. Already we defined what is J factor for mass transfer JD, and then JH for heat transfer. JD is defined as Kc by V infinity to the Smith number to the power of 2 by 3. It is said to be a JD factor in mass transfer according to Crichton-Corbin analogy. Similarly, for the J factor for heat transfer is given by JH is equal to standard number into Prandtl number to the 2 by 3. The standard number is given by Nusselt number and Reynolds number into Prandtl number, which is equal to H by rho Cp. So finally, they concluded that Crichton-Corbin analogy JD is equal to JH, which is equal to F by 2. This equation is said to be a Crichton-Corbin analogy. The analogy is valid for gases and liquids when the range Smith number is 0.6 to 2500 and the Prandtl number is 0.6 to 100. And this Crichton-Corbin analogy is mainly hold for flat plates, flow through pipes, and flow around cylinders. Another analogy is called Prandtl analogy, one of the most important analogy. According to the Prandtl analogy, the standard number is equal to F by 2 divided by square root of 1 plus 5 into square root of F by 2 into Prandtl power minus 1, PR minus 1 is Prandtl number minus 1. This with this correlation you are supposed to know. Okay, so this analogy is very important in the 16 marks question. So you have to explain what is Reynolds analogy, Crichton-Corbin analogy equation, and then Prandtl analogy equation, and finally one carbon analogy. So combining these three equations, Reynolds analogy, Crichton-Corbin, and Prandtl analogy, the one carbon has derived an analogy called one carbon analogy. The equation is Nusselt number, the big equation. You are supposed to remember, it is also very important 16 marks question. This Van Corman analogy is mainly used for turbulent flow through pipes. And another important talking we are going to see is mass transfer coefficient. This is one important 16 marks question. So what is the mass transfer coefficient already given? K, the K is to be a low mass transfer rates. and F is said to be a high mass transfer rate. If it is a turbulent region, we call it as a F. If it is a normal laminar region, it is called as a K. So F, what is F? F is defined as dAB into C divided by Z. That is nothing but flux. The flux is given by the coefficient multiplied by concentration gradient. This is the basic thing. Now we are going to use the basic equation to find out the relationship between the F and K. So this is one important 16 marks question frequently asked in university. What is the relationship between F and K? For deriving this equation, we need to know the basic equation in gases and liquids. This people already studied in modeling and transport. I am taking that basic equation, the final equation. The one is the transfer of air through stagnant B. It is NB is equal to zero. The flux equation. The flux equation is given by NA is equal to dAB into divided by Z into PT by RT into PA1 minus PA2 divided by rho into B. So this is the basic equation for a molecular diffusion in gases. So you are taking this equation, we are going to reduce it, and we are going to find out this equation. So here we know what is it? NA. NA is said to be a flux. The flux is given by kg into PA1 minus PA2. So we are changing the kg. The kg is nothing but we are substituting kg is equal to dAB divided by Z into RT into PT by PBM. So now the equation can be reduced into terms of F kg. The substituting kg is equal to F by rho BM. Already we know what is F. F is nothing but dAB into C divided by Z. So F is equal to kg into rho B into ln M. This is the equation considering the transfer of air through stagnant B. And similarly, the flux equation can be written for in terms of the mole fraction. C into dAB into Z into ln of 1 minus YA2 divided by 1 minus YA1. So this equation can be reduced as we know that YA1 plus YB1 is equal to 1 and YA2 plus YB2 is equal to 1. So the mass fraction is equal to 1. So now the equation is reduced in terms of mass fraction YA1 and YA2. Now we substituting what is KY, and then the equation can be written as F is equal to KY into PB ln M divided by PT. This is another equation. Similarly, if we consider the concentration in terms of concentration, in terms of mole fraction, in terms of concentration, C into dAB Z into ln of 1 minus CA2 by Z. So now we are using that CA1 by CB1 is equal to that equation. We are reducing the equation and finally we will be getting F is equal to KC into PB ln M divided by RT. This is another reduction, that is the relationship between F and K. So this is for equimolar. This is for one is diffusing, other one is non-diffusing. If you consider the equimolar counter diffusion, that is the flux equation, NA is equal to dAB into ZRT into PA1 minus PA2, considering the partial pressure. So we are reducing these equations. So this is very simple equation, just we are going to substitute the known values. So now the equation, whatever given in the box, it is said to be the final result. F is equal to KG prime PT and F is equal to KC prime into PT by RT, another equation. And similarly, the third equation, KY prime is equal to F. Now, whatever the given boxes, you need to sum up and finding out the relationship between the F and K, the big box, whatever written inside the coordinates, it is said to be a F and K relationship for gases. It's very important derivation. And similarly for liquids, we have to take the equimolar counter diffusion same manner by considering the mass fraction XA1, XA2, finding out the F and K relationship. And similarly for considering the transfer of air to stagnant B, the two relationship F is equal to KX into XBLM, another one is F is equal to KLM. Combining these two equations, we can write the overall equation F is equal to KL into CBLM, which is equal to KL into XBLM into C. So these both equation, the both table, whatever written in the boxes, it is used to the relationship between the F and K relationship. Very important 16 marks question. So again, the 2 marks question, what is the units for mass transfer coefficient? Whatever written, the KG prime and KG dash to be a moles transfer divided by area into time into pressure. Similarly, KX dash, KY dash and KX, KY, the units are moles transfer divided by area into time into mole fraction. Dimensionless numbers already discussed. And regarding the drying, we have already taken the problems. There are two types of problems most probably going to occur. And one of the first problem, or the problem to supposed to be do, you have to remember the formulas. The number one, the first formula is X. We already defined what is X. Capital X is said to be a dry basis and small x is said to be a wet basis. Capital X is given by X by 1 minus X, and another one is a time for concentrate drying is given by Lx divided by A into N into C into X1 minus Xc. And another one is time for falling rate period is Lx divided by AMC into Xc minus Xc star into ln of Xc star minus Xc divided by X2 minus Xc. So this is these three formulas. Another one is the total time is equal to concentrate time and falling rate time. You have to add it. These three formulas are important to solve the problem. So there are type 1 and type 2 problems in driving. Okay, the type 1 problem is we are going to discuss. I have given the notes, the workload problems. Just listen now. What is the question is, a woolen cloth is dried from initial moisture content of 100% to 10%. The critical moisture content is 55% and the equilibrium moisture content is 6%. And the woolen cloth thickness is given by 1.5 meter into 1.5 meter into 5 mm. That is the thickness. Drying rate also they given as 1.4 kg per hour meter square. They ask you to calculate the drying time. Okay. So we already know the formulas. The number one, first formula is x is equal to x by 1 minus x. If you wanted to find out then convert the dry basis into wet basis. Similarly, we have given x1. What is x1 is initial moisture content is 100%, which is equal to 1. X2, 10%, that is 0.1. And similarly, the xc, the critical moisture content is given as 55%, which is nothing but 0.55. So you have known values from the question. Equilibrium moisture content is given by 6%, that is given by 0.6. And then constant rate of drying, nc, is given as 1.4 kg per hour meter square. And then we have to find out the weight. So for finding out the LS dry weight, we need to know what is the area. The area they given as 1.5 into 1.5, that is length into breadth. Multiply, you find out the area. So we have find out the area and then NC, LS, X1, XC. Now the constant rate of drying PC is equal to LS divided by A into NC into X1 minus XC. So if you substitute all the values, you can find out the concentrate of time for concentrate of drying. Similarly, for falling rate period, we can find out LS by A into NC into XC minus XC into ln of XC minus XC divided by X2 minus XC. So we know the values, substitute the values, find out that time for falling rate. Now we need to add the total time. Total time is nothing but concentrate plus falling rate. We can add and we can find out the total time. The second problem is also similar problem. First type, we have to find out what is that X1. Here, you have one important thing we need to know. They are given in the wet basis. Okay, all the moisture content is given in the wet basis. So you have to find out in the dry basis. Similarly, a slab of paper pulp, the thickness is given is 1.5 meter, 5 mm, and they are given as drying condition is 15% to 8.5%, and the moisture critical moisture content is given. Drying rate also they are given, and then the density they are given is 0.22 gram per centimeter cube. So here we need to find out X1, capital X1. How to find out the X1? I already told. X by 1 minus x. So if you want to find out the small x1, you know the value of small x1, 15%, 0.15. Find out x1 by using the formula. Similarly, x2, all you have to find out in the dry basis. Convert the wet basis into dry basis. X1, x2, xc, xc. All the critical moisture content, initial moisture content, equilibrium moisture content. And then next step is area, finding out the area. And then they are given as a volume. So you need to find out from the volume. Area. So the method to find out the area from the volume is, you know, the volume is length into breadth into height. Find out the area. You have the relationship between the density and the mass. Density is equal to mass per volume. So find out from the density relationship, find out the thickness of the material. So once you find out the thickness of the material, substitute as usual formula, TC formula, TF formula, total formula T is equal to TC plus TF. And this is said to be a first method called drying, first method. The second method of drying is problem is, this is one type of problem. So what is the problem actually here is, they ask you to find out the different time period. For example, a filter cake is dried from 30 to 50 and it has to be dried, means you have to find out by choosing a case 1 and case 2. For example, the material is dried from 30 to 10%, that is 0.3 to 0.1%. So we have to find out in the wet, they are given the wet basis, convert into dry basis by using the formula x1 is equal to x by 1 minus x, x2 is xc and xc. So here we need to find out the total time. You can use it directly, you can combine the formula and we can able to find out the total time. So they ask you to find out for 5, they ask you to find out for 5 hours. Okay, so now we substitute the total time as 5 hours, substitute the all the values and find out the value of factor ls by anc. Okay, so here we are finding out the value of ls by anc. Substitute the value of ls by anc as a case 2. In case 2, so you have to consider the ls by anc value from the case 1 and substitute. And the condition you have to change is the second condition, that is nothing but 30 to 4, 6%. So we have to change the x1, x2 here. So now substituting the value from case 1 and value from case 2, we are finding out the time. That is said to be a type 2 problems, which is come under the drying. And similarly, another example, a dryer required some animals to dry the material from 33% to 9% on dry basis. Determine the time required to moisture from 37%. All are given in dry basis. So X1, X2, X3 is taken as a directly for 0.33, 0.09, 0.16, etc. Critical moisture content is given at 0.16. Equilibrium moisture content is given at 0.05. So now the same type, you have to find out the total time, TC plus TF. Add the two formulas. The equation you can write it as, considering the time of total time, that time is 7 hours. So substitute the value of 7 and so substitute the value of known values. Find out the unknown factor L by A and C. Now substitute the value of L by A and C in case 2 and finding out the drying period of 37% to 7% by taking X1, X2 different. So we need to find out the time, total time. Now if they are asking the extra time, we have supposed to make detect the difference between the two timing. For example, the 9.8 hours and 7 hours, the difference is 2.892 hours. Okay. So regarding that drying operation, so a very important thing you're supposed to learn in drying is, one is the first almost all know the drying equipments. Okay. Drying equipments, you have to supposed to draw four type of equipments, and you have to draw the diagram, you have to explain. Another important in drying is, you're supposed to derive the concentrate drying and falling rate period drying. The derivation is very important. And then problem. Problem is two types of problem we discussed here, type 1 and type 2. Similarly, and another important thing in the second unit, what you have not covered is convective mass transfer coefficient is. The important thing you have to find out from the study is F and K relationship for gases and liquids. Very important derivation. And another derivation, the another important question in what you call as convective mass transfer is analogy of mass heat momentum transfer. That is also we discussed here. So hopefully we have covered that whatever the topics are not covered in class timing. Okay. So I hope everyone learn some important topics in drying. So all the best. Be safe and study well. Thank you. Thank you.